Here we go for the CMOS inverter design in subthreshold regime of the operation. So before we go to the actual CMOS inverter circuit, we can very quickly review the subthreshold equations for the MOSFET. So for N-channel MOSFET, you can see here. For this N-channel MOSFET, the drain current IDN equal to ION e to the power VGS minus the threshold voltage VTHN on NN divided by phi T into 1 minus e to the power VDS upon phi T, where ION is mu ON multiplied by COX, oxide capacitance, W by L of N transistor, NN minus 1 into phi T square, where the NN is subthreshold swing parameter, and this is equal to 1 plus CD upon COX, where CD is the depletion capacitance and COX is the oxide capacitance. So, if we please note that for these equations, mostly the standard symbols are used. So if this equation, if the current equation is plotted here on logarithmic scale, log of IDS versus the gate to source voltage VGS. So in subthreshold regime, we get a linear variation of the current with gate to source voltage, and then current saturated in the so-called super threshold region, where VGS greater than VTHN, we call this region to be a super threshold region, where the conventional CMOS inverter is designed. For VGS less than VTHN, this region is basically the subthreshold region. So the transistor will be biased in this region only. So the supply voltage VDD, which will be chosen for the circuit design, will be taken will be in this range only. Okay, it could be from zero. It could be maximum value could be even it should be smaller than that of this VTHN, the threshold voltage of N transistor. So, if VGS of gate to source voltage of this transistor is considered to be zero, if VGS is made to be zero, if gate is sorted to the source, then this VGS term will be zero here. And therefore, the current IDSN will be very, very small. Although it's already small, but with smaller gate to source voltage value, it is going to be even very small. And this expression which is written here for NMOS transistor can also be extended for a PMOS transistor. So for PMOS transistor, we can do the following modifications so that we can use the same expression for a PMOSFET. What we can do, we can replace the gate to source voltage by VGS by VSG. VDS, the drain to source voltage, should be replaced by VSD. Mu N should be replaced by mu OP. Mobility of electron should be replaced by hole mobility. The aspect ratio W by L of N transistor will be replaced by W by L of P transistor. Then the subthreshold factors NN should be replaced by NP. And the threshold voltage VTHN must be replaced by mod of VTHP. So if we do modification in the above expression, this expression of the subthreshold current, we can get the subthreshold current expression for a PMOS transistor. So it could be IDP, the subthreshold current for a PMOS transistor is IOP, exponential VSG minus VTHP upon NP by T into 1 minus e to the power minus VSD on phi t. So It is again clear, it can be noted from this expression that if this VSG is made equal to zero, means if the gate voltage and source of the P transistor are kept at the same potential, that could be since the source of the P transistor in a CMOS inverter circuit will be at the VDD level. When the gate is given a high input level, which is equal to VDD, then source to gate potential will be very small, it will be zero, and therefore this subthreshold current IDP will be very, very small in that case. Ideally, it may not be, it is not necessary that it will be zero, but definitely it will be very, very small. These two equations can be the two current expression for N transistors and P transistor respectively can be used to design a CMOS inverter in a subthreshold regime of operation. So the circuit is similar to that of the conventional circuit. You can see the VDD is the supply voltage and input voltage is given here. Output voltage will be taken from this node, and the Cout, the load capacitance, Cout is the output capacitance, which is load capacitance. This includes related parasitic capacitances at this particular node, plus the interconnects, plus the capacitance.
Circuit is not
visible. Yeah.
Circuit is not visible. Circuit is not visible. No, sir.
PDF file is not visible.
Now it is visible actually.
No, yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Okay. So I was telling about this circuit, and this is basically similar to that of conventional circuit. The only difference is this VDD is now, it will be less than the threshold voltage of the N transistor VTHN and mod of VTHP. Otherwise, it's similar to that of a conventional CMOS circuit, and the C out here, the load capacitance, as I was telling, that it is calculated similar to how it was calculated for, or how it was estimated for a conventional CMOS inverter case. It includes both the parasitic capacitance, the interconnect capacitance, and the input capacitance of the next stage. This is Cout. So the VDD for a conventional VDD for this CMOS inverter case, you can see here, it should be less than VTHN, and it should also be less than mod of VTHP, and for a symmetrical design, generally we consider the threshold voltage of the two transistor to be same. Mod of this VTHP should be made equal to mod of this VTHN. This is one of the criteria. There will be many more, but this should also be ensured that the two threshold voltage will the two transistors will have equal threshold voltage value, at least in magnitude. So that supply voltage here is VDD is less than VTH, so the two transistors will always be in the subthreshold condition, and therefore if we apply the KCL, if you write the KCL equation at this output node, then we can write the drain current of N transistor should be equal to drain current of the P transistor, and the drain current of N transistor, as it was mentioned earlier, it is ION e to the power VGS minus VTHN upon NN phi t into 1 minus e to the power VDS upon phi t equal to IOP exponential VGS minus VTHP upon NB phi t into 1 minus PST upon phi t. So now the gate to source voltage and the drain to source voltages of the two transistors can be replaced by can be written in terms of the input voltage V in and the output voltage V out of this inverter circuit. So we can now do the following substitution in the above, in this KCL, this KCL expression. We can make the following substitution. So VGS or the N transistor is of course equal to the input voltage V in. You can see here VGS of this transistor is equal to V in. The VDS of N transistor is equal to V out into source voltage of the N transistor is equal to V out. And VSG, the source to gate potential of P transistor. To get potential, so this is of course equal to VDD minus V in. So VSG equal to VDD minus V in, and the source to drain potential for the P transistor is VDD minus V out. V source to drain potential of the P transistor is VDD minus V out. Now these modifications can be made in this expression. Which was written after comparing the two currents, we get the following expression: I on e to the power V in minus VTHN. Now VGS is replaced by V in, and VDS is replaced by V out. Similarly, VSG is replaced by VDD minus V in, and VSD is replaced by VDD minus V out. Now we can rearrange the terms of this expression so that the terms related with the input voltage can be taken one side, and terms related with the output voltage can be written on the other side. And at the same time, if this assumption is made, NN equal to NP equal to NN means the subthreshold factor of both N transistor and P transistor is equal same. Then we can modify this expression as this. So you can see that the left hand side of this expression is an expression for equation for V out as a variable. So 1 to the power exponential VDD minus V out divided by 1 minus exponential minus VDD V out by phi t. The left hand side is an equation of V in. So I on upon IOP exponential to V in minus VDD minus VTHN mod of VTHP upon NN phi t. So this is the voltage transfer characteristics equation, VTC equation of the CMOS inverter circuit. And you can see that there is not a closed form solution for, I mean, V out is not expressed explicitly in terms of the input voltage, but with the help of computer simulation, of course, you can write a code for this expression, and you will be able to plot the voltage transfer characteristics of the CMOS inverter. So here you can see that the output voltage is plotted with the input voltage, and if you look at this expression, you can very easily guess that if you increase V in, then the V out is going to decrease. So when the V out is plotted versus V in, we get this kind of variation. We get here, we see that for increasing input voltage, output voltage starts decreasing, and then there is a sudden change. A slope will be very high in this region, which is referred as the transition region, and then again it changes slowly with the input voltage. So its characteristics is almost similar to that of a conventional CMOS characteristics, and these characteristics can be divided into the three regions for the further analysis. We can assume that at this point, okay, the slope of this section is minus one. So divide this whole characteristics in three region. The first region where the V out is close to VDD. So this is the region where V out is close to VDD. In this region, Then there is a transition region, which is another one. And then this is the region where Vout is very, very less than VDD. So we don't have a closed form expression here for the voltage transfer characteristics. But if we do the region-wise simplification in this equation, then we can get a simplified expression for the output voltage in terms of input voltage. For example, so here you see that there are three regions. First region is Vout almost equal to VDD. Second region is Vout much smaller than VDD. And third region is transition region from when the output is changing from high level to low level. So for region one, the following simplification can be made. In region one, since Vout is close to VDD, then we can say that 1 minus exponential Vout upon pi t. Pi t is thermal voltage, which is very small, very, very small, of order of 25 millivolt, let's say, at the room temperature. And Vout is VDD, so this 1 minus e to the power minus VDD upon pi t, this term can be considered to be very small compared to this one, and this can be neglected, and therefore you can write down 1 minus e to the power minus V out upon pi t equal to 1. But to ensure that this term is, since we are neglecting this term, so if you'd like to quantify what should be the maximum value for this term which can be neglected, so this is 0.1. If this is less than 0.1, then this can be neglected compared to 1 here in this case. And this condition gives rise to the following relations for the Vout. So e to the power minus Vout upon phi t should be less than 0.1, and this gives rise to a relation that Vout should be close to 2.3 times phi t. So if Vout is output voltage greater than 2.3 times phi t, then we can say that this 1 minus e to the power minus Vout upon phi t is almost equal to 1. We can use this simplification, we can use this assumption in this VTC expression, and we can get the following expression for the output voltage. So V out here can be expressed in terms of V in. So right hand, left hand side only has V out term, and the left hand side is V in term. So V out equal to, you can see, VDD minus phi t natural log of 1 upon 1 minus I on upon I of P exponential to V in minus VDD minus VTH n plus phi THP upon NNVT. So here, upon using that simplification, that simplified this. Simplification in the VTC, now we are able to write an explicit expression for the Vout. Similarly, for region 2, the region 2 is the region where Vout is considered to be very, very small VDD. So in this region, basically, we are talking about this region. So when Vout is much, much less than VDD, then we can further, we can again get some simplification. And in this case, so you can see that the term 1 minus exponential minus VDD minus Vout upon phi t can be now be simplified, because now we are considering Vout is much, much less than VDD. So if Vout is less than VDD, let's say that it is negligible compared to VDD. So this expression can be written as 1 minus e to the power minus VDD upon phi t, because Vout is considered to be 0 in this case, and therefore now this can be simplified to be 1. And again, to make this happen, we have to consider that this exponential term is less than 0.1. And if we apply this condition here, we get a relation for Vout. That case, Vout is less than equal to VDD minus 2.3 times phi t. So if this condition is true, if Vout is less than VDD minus 2.3 phi t, then we can use this approximation in the voltage transfer characteristics equations that we have discussed earlier, and we get the following simplified expression for the P out. Then V out equal to now phi t natural log of 1 upon 1 minus IOP upon IN exponential minus 2 V in minus VDD minus VTHN upon mod of VTHP upon NNVT. So we have got the simplified expression for the output voltage in this region, in region 1 and this region, region 2. In fact, this is region 2 and the transition region is considered to be region 3. Okay, in transition region, the slope of this characteristics can be computed. The slope of characteristics can be computed by considering that the P transistor, is you can see that the output is changing very quickly with respect to the change in the input voltage. So it's a kind of you can see a voltage amplification. This region, in this region, there is a significant voltage gain offered by this circuit. And in this transition region, the CMOS inverter can be considered as an amplifier, where the N transistor is the active device, and the P transistor can be considered to be the load of this N transistor. If you are considering this, then we can very easily, it could be a kind of common source amplifier. And for a common source amplifier, the gain factor can be computed. The gain factor for a common source amplifier is here minus GMN, the transconductance of the N transistor, multiplied by RON parallel ROP. RON is the output resistance of the N transistor. ROP is the resistance offered by the P transistor. So the slope of this transition region, the slope of the transition region can be given by this expression minus GMN upon NN GMN plus NP GMP. So this can be very easily determined by considering that the inverter is working as an amplifier in that transition region. Okay, so now we have got the simplified expression for the output voltage V out in region 1 and region 2, and we will consider that the point where the slope of this VTC becomes 1. So first, this point will is in the region 1, and we'll also consider that the second point of the VTC where the derivative of the voltage with respect to input goes 1 in region 2. So we can use the two equations of the output voltage of region 1 and region 2 to compute the voltage level VIL and VIH. Okay, VIL, VIH, VOH, and VOL are the four important voltage levels, as you know, that can be used to determine the various noise margins of the CMOS inverter. So the next step in our discussion is to determine the voltage levels VIL, VIH, VOL, and VOH, so that we can determine the noise margin of this CMOS inverter circuit. Okay. So here is the VTC, and VIL is the input voltage at which the slope goes minus 1, and VIH is again the input voltage where slope goes minus 1, and VOH is the maximum voltage level, let's say in this case, and VOL is the minimum output voltage in this case. So VOH will be close to VDD and VOL should be close to 0. So to compute VOH and VOL, to find out, we can assume that if V in, the input voltage, is equal to VOL, then the output voltage of the inverter will be equal to VOH, or V in equal to VOL, the output will be VOH. And if V out is equal to VOH, then e to the power minus VOH upon phi t can be neglected, because VOH is equal to VDD, so e to the power minus VDD upon phi t will be a small term, so it could be neglected. And we can substitute, we can put V in equal to VOL. In ideal case, it should be equal to zero. So if you could put V in equal to V zero, then we can find out the output voltage V out. We can find out VOH in the equations that we have derived for the region one. So in region one, if we substitute this, V in equal to zero, then V out becomes equal to VOH, and here we get the expression for VOH. So VOH is equal to, you can see, VDD plus phi t natural log of 1 minus I on upon IOP e to the power minus VDD minus VTH upon N phi t 1 mod of VTHP. So it seems that this VOH will be close to VDD. And of course, this term probably should be negative, so that this VOH may be slightly smaller than this VDD. For, in ideal condition, if VTHN is considered to be mod of VTHP and e to the power minus VD upon NN phi t is considered to be 1, then this VOH is turns out to be VDD, because in that case, this term, the second term, it becomes log of, natural log of 1, so it's 0, and VOH become equal to VDD. So similarly, the VOL can be computed. For VON, if you consider V in equal to VOH equal to VDD, then the V out must be equal to VOL. And if we use V in equal to VOH equal to VDD in the VTC equation of region 2, then we can find out the following expression for the VOL. So you might have noticed that we are following the same procedure of the analysis that is used for the analysis of a conventional CMOS case. The only difference is the drive current expressions are different here. So the equations are appearing in a slightly different form. So VOL equal to the VOL level is computed here, which is equal to phi t natural natural log of 1 upon 1 minus I p on exponential minus VDD VTHN mod of VTHP upon NN phi t. So the total logic swing can be computed. Logic swing is if VOH is maximum level, VOL is minimum level. So subtracting VOL from VOH, we can get the rail to rail, you can say rail to rail voltage level, which is actually VDD plus phi t natural log of 1 minus IOP upon I on e to the power minus VDD VTHN plus mod of VTHP upon NN phi t. Now we can also determine the VIL and VIH. Any question, any doubt so far? Anybody has any doubt, please let me know. Is it okay for everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll go ahead now. We'll see the possible expression. We'll try to get the possible expression for VIL and VIH. And VIL and VIH are also determined in the similar fashion of the conventional CMOS inverter case. So you can see that when VI is equal to VIL, the derivative is V out upon V in must be equal to minus 1. When VI is equal to VIS, the derivative of the output voltage with respect to VIN must be equal to minus 1. So when VI is VIL, VI is equal to VIL, then the V out is approximately equal to VDD, but we will not substitute here V out equal to VDD, but rather we are going to use the VTC expression of region 1. So that expression will be differentiated with respect to Vin, and then we'll substitute Vi equal to Vil, and we'll put dV out upon dV in equal to minus 1, and then we'll be able to get the following expression for Vil. So Vil is VDD by 2 plus half VThN minus VThP NN phi T 2 log of NN by 2 into Ion upon IOP. Please note that this VIL is an explicit expression. Basically, this is not coming, the right hand side of this expression is not a function of V out. So, using this expression, we can very easily find out the VIL voltage level of the inverter. Whereas for VIH level, then we have to use the VTC equation of region 2. When VTC equation of the region 2 is differentiated with respect to Vin, and then by substituting Vi equal to Vih and dV out upon dV in equal to minus 1, we'll be able to get the following expression for Vih. So Vih turns out to be VDD by 2 plus half mod of VThN minus mod of VThP plus NN phi T natural log of NN by 2 Ion upon IP to the power V out upon phi T upon 1 minus E to the power minus V out upon phi T. So just like the conventional CMOS inverter case, VIN and VIH, VIL and VIH will be determined. And once the four parameters VOH, VOL, VIH and VIL are determined, then we can find out the respective low noise margin and high noise margin and low noise margin. So high noise margin is VOH minus VIH, and low noise margin is VIL minus VOL. So the respective equations for VOH, VIH, VIL and VIOL can be used to determine the noise margin. Now the threshold voltage of the inverter. So threshold voltage, you know, is the threshold voltage of the inverter is obtained by you can have if you have VTC and then you also plot V out equal to V in on that VTC, then the intersection point of the two characteristics give the logic threshold voltage. So the input voltage at which the V out equal to V in line will cut the VTC, that will be actually the logic the threshold voltage of the inverter. And the threshold voltage of inverter can be obtained by taking some approximation. So one of the approximation is that the input voltage, that the VT, the inverter threshold voltage should be close to the VDD by 2. So if it is close to VDD by 2, then we can have two simplification, 1 minus e to the power minus V out upon phi t, and we approximate it as 1 because now V out is VDD by 2, and 1 minus e to the power minus VDD minus V out upon phi t. So if you also substitute here V out equal to VDD by 2, then this exponential term, these two equations can be simplified as a 1, and therefore if we use these two simplifications and at the same time we also use V in equal to the logic threshold voltage VThN in the voltage transfer characteristics, then we'll be able to get the expression of the logic threshold voltage, the CMOS inverter threshold voltage equal to VDD by 2 plus half mod of VThN minus VThP plus NN phi T natural log of IP IOP upon ION. So from this expression, it is very obvious that if the two transistors are symmetric, means if the two transistors are having the same threshold voltage value in magnitude, and if the two currents, on current, ion, two scale currents for N transistor as well as P transistor, if these two are made equal sizing, proper sizing of the device dimension, then this term as well as this term, these two will become equal to zero, and therefore in that case the threshold inverter threshold voltage turns out to be VDD by 2, just in the middle of the total voltage swing. Okay, so we have already discussed about the different parameters of the CMOS inverter. We have discussed about the noise margins. We have also discussed about the threshold voltage of the inverter. Any question so far? Anybody? Any doubt? No. Okay. So now let us go ahead. We can now discuss about the static power dissipation, and static power dissipation has it could be this analysis could be similar to that of a conventional CMOS inverter case. So in this case we can consider that the leakage current is very small. Leakage current will be very small because its circuit is being designed with the leakage current only. So when get to source voltage VGS is equal to VDD, so in that case we are considering that the transistor is off. So in that case the level of the current will be very small, and therefore the static power dissipation, the power dissipation because of the leakage current, can be neglected. The DC power, however, the DC power consumption is equal to PDC equal to VDC into IDC. IDC is of course the average DC current. So average DC current can be computed based on the assumption that for the 50% of the time the output voltage is VDD, and for another 50% of the time the output voltage is equal to zero or VOL or zero, and for 50% it was VDD or VOH. So the IDC can be computed as half of I low plus I high, where I low is computed using this expression, IL equal to I on e to the power VOL, V in is now replaced by VOL, and minus VTHN upon NN phi t into 1 minus e to the power VOH upon phi t. So to compute IL, it is assumed that input voltage V in is VOL level, and the output voltage of the N transistor is at the high level. So VOH is equal to VDD and VOL is zero in this case. And if V in is equal to VOL, V out is equal to VOH, then this can be simplified. This expression can be simplified because we are considering VOL to be zero and VOH very high, close to VDD. This terms is negligible. So 1 minus e to the power minus VOH minus VTH can be approximated as a 1. And at the same time, this, since VOL equal to 0, it becomes e to the power minus VTHN upon NN phi t. So the IL becomes I on e to the power minus VTHN upon NN phi t. And similarly, the high level current IH can be determined. The high level current, it is considered that the input is high at the VOH level and the output V out is at the lower level VOL. So substituting V in equal to VOH and V out equal to VOL, we can get the following expression for the high current IH. And then using I low and I high, this expression IDC, and finally IDC in this expression, will be able to compute this EDC, DC power dissipation, which is equal to, which is a kind of average current, which is equal to VDD by 2 I on. This is a contribution of IL, and this is the contribution of IH. Okay. Now the propagation delay can also be determined. So propagation delay is an important parameter because since the VDD supply voltage is low, this is going to be significantly very high. So first we will try to derive an expression, discuss an expression for the propagation delay. Later on we'll see the try to observe see the graph and try to get the important information. We'll try to note the order of the propagation delay in the CMOS inverter which is operating in subthreshold regime of the operation. So propagation delay at TP, this is also done in the similar way as it is computed in conventional case. So the propagation delay is TP, TP low to high plus TP high to low divided by 2, and we can compute it TP low to high and TP high to low. For calculating the TP low to high, what is assumed here that for this inverter case, CMOS inverter case, the input voltage is, let's say, that changing immediately at T equal to 0. Equal to 0, it becomes VDD. So it's a simplified case. We are not considering the rise time here or fall time for the input waveform for calculating propagation delay. So if the rise time of the input signal is 0, t at t equal to 0, it all of a sudden reaches to VDD, and when Vin is high, then this transistor, N transistors, will be conducting, and this will provide a path for the V out, the path for the discharge, for this capacitor to discharge itself. At the same time, sir, V in has gone to VDD, so VSG for this transistor, P transistor, is equal to 0. So the current that is that this transistor can deliver, P transistor can deliver, is very, very small. So the capacitor will discharge through the N transistor. So if the output voltage here is initially at the VDD level when the input was 0, input reaches to VDD, then output will start decreasing from VDD to lower value. You can see, so output will here discharge, decrease from high value to low value, and the high to low propagation delay is the time required to reach the output level from VDD to VDD by. Okay, so this TP high to low can be very easily calculated by writing a KCL at this particular node. So this is the current that is flowing through the N transistor. So the N transistor current is I on e to the power exponential VDD minus VTH upon NN phi t, because V in we are considering to be VDD. So V in is VDD here, and minus VTHN upon NN phi t into 1 minus e to the power minus V out, because we are considering that the output voltage is changing with respect to time here, because since the capacitor is discharging itself, the potential across this capacitor will change with respect to time. So this is considered to be a variable parameter V out divided by phi t equal to minus C out dV out by dt. And it is considered that the current that can be supported by the P transistor is very, very small in this case. And therefore, that current is neglected. So the N transistor current is equated with the capacitive current here. So when comparing these two equations and rearranging the terms, to the left hand side, we have this integration. The limit is changing from VDD to VDD by 2, V out upon 1 to the power 1 minus e to the power V out upon phi t. And to the left hand side, we have I on e to the power VDD minus VTHN upon NN phi t upon C out. And the integration is from 0 to TP high to low DT. And this integration here can be solved in order to determine the high to low propagation delay. TPHL is C out phi t upon I on e to the power VDD minus VTHN upon NN phi t. Natural log of 1 minus e to the power VDD upon phi t e to the power minus VDD upon 2 phi t minus e to the power minus VDD upon phi t. And similarly, tau p low to high can also be computed when V in is zero. When we let's say that initially Vin was VDD and at t equal to zero, Vin is reduced set from it changed from VDD to zero. Then in this case, N transistor can be considered to be off. P transistors will be on, and there will be charging current, and this charging current will be responsible for the rising up of potential at this particular node. So we can consider the TP low to high as the time elapsed, time required to increase the potential here from 0 to VDD by 2. And similarly, a KCL expression can be written for the P transistor and this capacitor, and we'll be able to find this following expression. TP low to high equal to C out phi T upon IOP e to the power VDD minus mod of VTHP and then phi T natural log of e to the power minus VDD by phi T e to the power minus VDD upon 2 phi T e to the power minus VDD upon phi T. The two expressions are, you can see that almost similar. C out phi T, only ION is replaced by IOP exponential VDD, VTHN replaced by mod of VTHP and then phi T. Logarithmic terms are also similar. So for a symmetric inverter, if the charging time, charging and discharging, if both currents are same, and if the two transistors are sized properly, so ION will be equal to IP. In this that case, this TP high to low must be equal to TP low to high, and therefore propagation delay can be equal to either TP high to low or TP low to high. Of TPHL TLH can be used to compute the total propagation delay. Okay. So here is the conclusion. In subthreshold regime, the propagation delay is much larger than above threshold region because of the two regions. One region is very clear that in subthreshold region, the voltage levels are very small. VDD is very small, so the drive current is going to be very small. That's why if drive current is very small, then charging discharging process will be very slow. And if the charging discharging process is slow, then of course the delay will be much larger. Okay, this is one region. Another region which is also prominent here, and in fact the second region is not considered here in our analysis, which is the high contention current. What is the contention current? So contention current is basically that can be understood here. Let's say that the input is changed from 0 to VDD, and in that case this P transistor is supposed to be in off condition, N transistor is to be in on condition, and this N transistor is going to facilitate the discharging of this capacitor. So this ion current will flow. But since this P transistor will also be leaking a current IOP, which is not going to be zero. And this IOP in a real circuit will be very, very significant. And since this IOP is going to act against this ION, because this ION is going to discharge this capacitor, and this whatever the IOP will be, although it's smaller than this ION, this is going to charge this capacitor. So this IOP is going to oppose this ION. That's why we call this contention current, and the contention current is comparatively significant in case of a subthreshold circuit than that of the conventional circuit. So therefore this high contention current will also delay the discharging process, and therefore the delay will also increase because of this. So the two regions here, the low driving current and high contention current, are responsible for the significantly large delay in the circuit which is designed in the subthreshold regime of the device operation. So we discuss about propagation delay, static power dissipation. Now DC power dissipation, in fact leakage current was considered to be small, leakage power dissipation was considered to be small. So switching power dissipation can also be computed in the similar fashion as it is done in conventional CMOS case. So P switching is the clock frequency F, VDD, I equal to 1 to N, alpha I, CLI, V swing. So V swing is the change in the potential at that particular node. Alpha I is the switching activity at that particular node. And CLI is the load capacitance at that particular node. If the V swing, the swing of the voltage change at the particular node is rail to rail, means if V swing is VDD minus zero, then this expression turns out to be alpha F C out into VDD square. And at the same time, we are also considering that alpha is one. So switching activity is for each and every change in the for each and every clock, there is a switching activity happening at that particular node. Then this expression P switching is alpha F C out into VDD square. So this is similar to that of conventional CMOS case. However, the short circuit power dissipation will be slightly different. I mean, this will also be present here, and this is significant compared to that of the conventional case because of the following reason. Okay, so short circuit power dissipation, you know, when the two transistors are on together, N transistors and P transistors are on together, there is a path between from VDD to ground, and that leads to power dissipation that will be responsible for the power dissipation. So you can see here the short circuit power dissipation. Let's say that the input signal is like this. TR is rise time, it is increasing, then constant, then it falls back here in time TF. So unlike the conventional case, conventional CMOS inverter case, here you'll see that when the input voltage just started to increase, the short circuit current will also, this is short circuit current ISC. Short circuit current also starts increasing in, with the input voltage. Whereas in the conventional case, when V in T, input voltage was greater than VTHN, then only the short circuit current becomes significant. When V in was less than VTHN, one of the transistor, N transistor, was off in that for conventional case. But here, the short circuit current will start increasing along with V in, reaches to maximum value, and then it falls down. And similarly, during this time interval, fall time of the input signal, the same trend is observed. Okay, so this short circuit power dissipation, short circuit can also be computed in the similar fashion. We can consider that V in input voltage is zero for T less than equal to zero. And when V in for time period zero to TR during this interval, the input voltage is changing linearly. V in T is considered to be equal to VDD into T upon TR. Going a little bit quickly because the procedure has already been discussed for a CMOS inverter case, a CMOS inverter case. So V in T equal to VDD upon T upon TR. So the instantaneous short circuit current can be ISC T ion e to the power V in T minus VTHN upon NN phi T 1 minus e to the power minus V out upon phi T. So the current expression for N transistor is basically used to write down the expression for this short circuit current. Okay, so V in T here can be replaced by this expression VDD into T upon TR, and V out will be changing with respect to time. So if we write an expression for V out that will be time dependent, then will lead to a complicated expression for ISC. So to get a simplified expression for the V out is considered to be V by 2. We get the following expression for the short circuit current ISC ion. This is instantaneous short circuit current. And to get the average short circuit current, we have to integrate this with have to get 1 upon capital T 0 to T ISC T dt, and 1 upon T 0 to T, the ISC expression is substituted here, which was discussed earlier, dt. And this can be simplified as 2 upon capital T 0 to TR, considering that the two currents waveform, this waveform and this waveform, these are identical. So if it is so, then this can be this expression can be simplified as 2 upon capital T 0 to TR, and this is the same expression here as written here, dt, and therefore we get the following expression for ISC average: 2 NN VTS TR upon VDD upon T ION e to the power minus VTHN IT into 1 minus e to the power VDD upon 2 phi T VDD upon NN phi T minus 1. So the average short circuit power dissipation is VDD into ISC average, and this ISC average will be multiplied with VDD, will get the expression for P average. So if you look at the expression for the average short circuit power dissipation, then we see that this is proportional to e to the power minus VTH upon NN phi T. So increasing the threshold voltage of the transistor will reduce this short circuit power dissipation. Increasing rise time will also increase the short circuit power dissipation. And increasing the clock frequency will also increase the short circuit power dissipation. Okay. So if you recall, there was a technique for reducing the short circuit power dissipation in a conventional CMOS case. What was that? Can anybody comment how to minimize short circuit power dissipation in conventional CMOS inverter case? Anybody? See that by voltage scaling, when we said VDD equal to VTHN plus VTHP, so for this condition, you see that if you recall, the two transistors cannot be on together. Okay. So if the two transistors were not on together, then we couldn't get, we cannot observe the short circuit power. This is a short circuit current in conventional CMOS inverter case. But in this case, in conventional, in a subthreshold, when the inverter is designed in the subthreshold regime of the device operation, even if you put VDD equal to mod of VTHN plus VTHP, the two transistors will be on together, and the short circuit power dissipation will be significant in this case. Even by voltage scaling in this particular fashion, we cannot completely suppress the short circuit power dissipation. Okay, so let us stop here today. We will continue this discussion in the next class. Okay, meanwhile, I will send this PDF to all of you, and you also go through it. And I hope that this is a very easily each and every steps are given, except some integration. So whatever missing here, you can try your own, you can perform the integration, and you can try to find these equations. Okay, next class we'll discuss the remaining part, and we'll also analyze the delay and the power dissipation quantitatively. Okay, we'll look at the data, and we'll see how this subthreshold design can be where it can stand compared to a conventional CMOS circuit. Okay. So any question, if you have, you can just ask. Okay.
Sir.
Yes. Mohiji, please.
Punes.
Yes, Punes.
जैसे नॉर्मल सीमॉस में हम लोग कहते हैं VGS greater than VTH तो ऑन होगा, तो उस तरह से सब थ्रेशोल्ड में क्या कंडीशन होगा सर ऑन होने के लिए?
है ना, यही तो प्रॉब्लम है. सब थ्रेशोल्ड में इट्स ऑलवेज ऑन व्हेन VGS इज You can see, just look at this characteristic. Okay. So in conventional design, when VGS is less than VTH, we say the transistor is off, because actually the transistor will not be off, but since the current level in subthreshold is much lesser than, you see that this current here is much larger than this current. Okay, so this current can be neglected compared to this current. So for conventional design, we can say that this current is neglected compared to this. So when the VGS is less than VTH, when VGS is less than equal to VTH, this part was neglected compared to this part. But in subthreshold design, we are designing the circuit in this region only. Okay, so one point is here and another point is, let's say, here. So this point cannot be neglected compared to this. Okay, is it clear now? Is it? I mean, can you see this picture?
Yes, sir.
So, what I was telling, that in conventional case, basically the on current was this and off current was this. Okay. So when VGS was less than VTH, then the current, this current is very very small. Logarithmic scale. So in logarithmic scale, this current is negligible compared. If you design your circuit in the subthreshold, then the two points are close to each other. Maybe your VDD is here, and one current is here, which is the highest current, and another current is here. Okay. So now this current cannot be this the lower current cannot be neglected completely compared to this current. Okay. So you see that, you can say that it's kind of always on, but the off current that we are considering is much smaller than this current, because this the current is changing in logarithmic scale. So even if the two points are considered in subthreshold region, the lower current can be many order of magnitude smaller than the subthreshold current. So the lower current, when the lower current will flow, we can consider as if the transistor is in off condition in that case. Getting my point? For a scale transistor, there is nothing like completely off condition. Okay. Okay. But since the current is changing exponentially, then the current here at one point can be significantly smaller than the current at the other point. So where the current is very small, that can be considered. If the current, very small current will flow, we can consider that transistor is in off condition compared to the other point. Okay. Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
Any other question, anybody?
Sir, in conventional CMOS, sir, if the voltage supply voltage is less than VTN and VTP summation, then there will be some hysteresis effect.
Sir, yes, sir.
In subthreshold region, is there any such kind of effect?
In this case, the two transistors will always be on, even if your VDD is less than VTHN plus VTHP. The two trans, because you see that the hysteresis was why? It was because when V in is in the range of 0 to VTHN, the N transistor was off. And similarly, when the P transistor voltage was in the range of VDD plus mod of VTHP to VDD, that transistor was in off condition completely. Okay, but in this case, at the moment V in goes above 0, the N transistors will be on, and at the moment V in goes below VDD, the P transistor is always on. So the two transistors are always on in this case. Okay. I don't think that kind of behavior will be observed here. Two transistors are always on, so current will be flowing through the two transistor. If you want to see the VTC in that condition, then you can simply use the VTC equation, and you can set VDD equal to mod of VTHN less than mod VTHN plus mod of VTHP, and you can see which kind of characteristics you will see. I think that it will be like a regular CMOS inverter only. Okay, it will not have the hysteresis. However, if I am wrong, you can just correct me. Okay. Because the two transistors will always be on in this case.
Yes.
Oh. Any other question? Okay. So I will send this PDF to all of you for your reference. Okay. Thank you very much.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Bye.